Dear students, welcome to Deep, Daily Editorial Enrichment Program by La Excellence R&D team. Today, let's discuss the articles of October 5, 2019. Let's understand today's first article, that is In Search of Wuhan Spirit. Wuhan was the informal meeting that happened between India and China during 2018. The second such meeting, an informal summit between India and China, would be happening in the second week of October. In this article, let's understand what were the outcomes of Wuhan summit, what are the challenges ahead of Mamallapuram summit, and how is it India-China relationships in recent days. So this article is important in the context of GS paper 2, India-China relations in the international arena. After the Doklam standoff between India and China, the relations between them deteriorated. So in order to improvise its relationships, India proposed for an informal summit to sort out all the issues. Therefore, the first informal summit happened in China, that is in the Wuhan province in 2018. So what was the major outcome of this Wuhan province? The first one is they understood the importance of having the peace and tranquility in the India-China border. Therefore, they suggested for having an eye-level strategic communications between India and China. The second thing, major important outcome of the Wuhan summit was the joint economic project that is supposed to be taken up in the Afghanistan. Despite Wuhan summit, there is no much progress between the India-China relationships. There is no real breakthrough which has been happened. The chance of this joint economic project within the Afghanistan is very less. So therefore, what is the options that is available in front of India and China today? So the one is going for a second informal summit that is going to happen in Mamallapuram. See, why is this Mamallapuram has been selected as a place for meeting? So one, it is because Mamallapuram has been known for its renowned architecture, which is admired across the world. The second most important reason is the security pact that was signed between India and China during the 8th century period. At 8th century, Raja Narasimha or Narasimha Varma, that is a Pallava king, was sought help by the Chinese people to counter Tibet. So that's where the Indian king provided his help to the Chinese to counter the Tibet. Therefore, Mamallapuram is selected as a symbolic choice to ensure the India-China relationship to the other fortunes or to the other levels. Post-Wuhan challenges, what are the challenges that we currently face? See, there has been a contradictory outlook between India and China's views. It may be in the strategic as well as the civilizational aspect. It may be in terms of the Asian security aspects or the matters of regional stability or the role that has been US played in the region as a US pivot policy, then China-Pakistan equations, and the final one where UN designated Jaish-e-Mohammed chief Masood Azhar as a global terrorist. So these points have been a contradictory between India and China. So this is the post-development of 2018 that we have to keep in mind before we move on to the Mamallapuram summit. So then what are the specific challenges that India faces and the specific challenges that China's concerns are? Let's understand further. Post-Yuan summit, China's status has declined because many countries have started opposing to the Belt and Road initiative of China, and there has been unrest happening in Xinjiang and the Hong Kong province. Continuing trade war between USA and China has affected the trade relationships, also affecting the economic growth. There is constant issue of South China dispute between the various countries bordering the South China and the Vietnam issues. So all these things have affected the China stature, whereas India's stature has improved a lot. So India has got a very good relationship with USA. Then India's relationship with Russia also has strengthened. With quadrilateral program, India's relation with Japan has also got strengthened. Therefore, India's position relatively improved after the first Wuhan summit. With the virtue of improvement of India's stature, India is trying to deal China with an aggressive stance. Say for example, the Changthang Prahar, which is going to happen in the Ladakh. See, Changthang Prahar is a high, super high altitude area near the eastern Ladakh, where all arms integrated exercise would be taking place. Then it may be in case of the reopening of advanced landing ground at Vijoynagar in Arunachal Pradesh. So this has raised the concerns between India and China as of now. Therefore, when India is going to the Mamallapuram summit, it shall be careful in approaching the relationships, and we shall be taking care of a multifaceted approach while dealing with China. Let's move on to the next article, that is Web of Deception. The government must monitor the NEET admission process to guard against the fraud. This article is important in the context of GS Paper 2 issues related to education. See, we all are well aware, what is NEET? NEET is a national level entrance examination that is conducted for the students who wants to undergo an undergraduate medical courses and dental courses, either it may be in the government college or in the private colleges, including the dental colleges. Who is conducting this NEET examination? It is being conducted by the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare and National Testing Agency. So why did they go for this All India level entrance examination? They wanted to standardize the testing for admissions into medical colleges, okay, and to ensure that a minimum quality is being followed while the entrance examination happens. But however, the scam that has happened in the NEET makes people to lose confidence in the examination process. This scam involves which a student who committed fraud by having someone impersonating him at the NEET examination. So this shows us there is a serious lapse in the procedures that is being followed during the examination. Also, this scam destroys the integrity of the NEET test as an All India level entrance examination. Therefore, the government as well as the National Testing Agency should have a zero tolerance to such attempts. They shall identify the lacunas, whatever is present in the existing system, and ensure there would be a foolproof testing methodology in place. For example, having an impartial inquiry about the case. Next, using biometrics for the students who are taking up the NEET examination. And imbibing the ethical behavior among the students and parents also is need of the hour. Let's move on to the next article, that is Rethinking the College Recruitment. See, this article, they are trying to say the tenure track system that is being introduced in IITs for the recruitment of the faculties. This tenure track system is not only introduced in IITs, the Ministry of HRD is also planning to extend the system to other central universities, and the National Education Policy is also recommending it to be introduced in all the institutions by 2030. Therefore, it's a very important article related to the issues of education in GS Paper 2. How is that an assistant professor is appointed to the job? Earlier, what used to happen is an assistant professor would be appointed for a probationary period of 1 year. After a period of 1 year, they would be confirmed with a service. What has to happen? Any point of time during the probationary period, their performance analysis was not made. There was no evaluation. How are they performing with respect to the research? Okay. So with this, what happened? The probationary period, however, they knew that, you know, after 1 year, they'll be confirmed. They did not focus on the research part. Okay, because of which more than half of the assistant professors who have been hired are underperforming. So to change this attitude, a new tenure track system, as like in the US, we imported this model. Here what they basically do is, after PhD, an assistant professor is hired and his performance will be measured for more than 5.5 years. Okay, and this assessment will be made by an independent external committee. So when an external committee analyzes their performance, their research progress, what is being made, if the performance is good, they would continue them and make them as a permanent employees and promote them as an assistant professors. If the performance is not that up to the mark, they can ask them to leave. Sometimes they may also give for 2 year extension period. So in this system, they try to measure the performance that of research that is being made by the assistant professors before confirming them with the service. So what is the advantage of the system? The people who have been hired will focus on the research, and at any point of time, their underperformance would not be there. That's where it combines the positivity of academic freedom with that of accountability and responsibility. As we could see with the US system where the tenure track system was followed, it is clear that this process of tenure system does not guarantee any excellence or improved accountability. The criticism would be that, see, we are trying to control these young faculties. So we are trying to control them and keep them tight unless and until they prove their performance. So we are not giving them the permanency status. So this could be sometimes a counterproductive thing. See, the risk of not getting their jobs can make young recruits not to take any difficult decision. So the third important issue that is to be raised here is, so we are focusing extremely on the young faculties, whereas we are leaving these senior faculties to be unmonitored. So their performance are really not monitored in the system. So how do we go for symmetry between the senior faculties and the new fresh recruitment? Okay, so the Ministry of HRD, instead of focusing only on this tenure system, it shall also give emphasis for the infrastructure that is required to conduct sufficient research. So we are telling them the performance will be based on the research that is being done. So but do we have this adequate infrastructure to support their research? So India definitely doesn't have. And the biggest problem is the age limit of 35 years, which seems to be more arbitrary. See, what happened is, usually the academic assistant professors would be of their age of around 30s, and the 5.5 years of assessment in the college by the external committee would take away the 35 or 36 years. So after an assessment, if they are left with no job, then in other universities will also be, it will be difficult for them to get their jobs. So it will be putting their lives at the risk. Another important trouble that researchers face is with respect to the funding. See, what happens is these IITs provide only a fund of 20 lakh rupees as a seed fund. Okay. With delay in dispersal of these funds, researchers may have to go up to the private agencies for the dispersal of funds. But what happens, even this, in this case, they have to fight with the well-established researchers to obtain the funds. So delay in the dispersal of funds has been a major challenge for many of the assistant professors to show their performance. Therefore, government, while introducing the tenure track system, should also focus on the underlying problems that researchers are facing. That would be a major challenge to find the good talent, and that may lead to the brain drain also. Moving on to the next article, that is moderate expectations. There are limits to what RBI can do with rates. The government needs to promote investments. See, we are all well aware that the monetary policy will be taken care by the RBI. Monetary policy in terms of interest rates, the inflation, all these parts will be taken care by the RBI, whereas a fiscal policy would be taken care by the government. So, what were possible steps that the RBI could take in terms of the monetary policy has been taken with a recent move wherein RBI reduced the interest rates by 25 basis points. So, RBI has reduced the interest rates, so they have kept inflation under the control. Now, to boost the GDP, the responsibility lies with the government also in the terms of fiscal policy. Government recently announced for the cuts in the corporate tax rate. This could be an example where the necessary steps that is being taken by the government. However, there is a challenge of fiscal slippage and higher borrowings that is being made by the government. So the only ray of hope is the festive season consumption by the people that may revive the economy to an extent and ensure that the growth rate goes to the next trajectory. Thank you.